this week on Strong Arm Sports Podcast.
Y'all see me? I got my Santa Claus hat on, bolo hitting me in the face. Pause. Pause.
I can't remember Christmas ever falling on a Sunday. I can't remember that. I really can't. But make this Christmas is a special
on a Sunday
before. In my life? What's going on, folks? Welcome to another exciting episode of Strong Arm Sports Podcast. True. We are the realest podcast in all the land. We've scoured the face of the earth, True. And we can't find one realer than us, man.
Word.
This is a special Christmas edition of Strong Arm Sports Podcast. If this happens to be the first time that you are watching or listening, I go by the name of K-Spade the Prospect.
And I'm your boy, LeParis57, and together we form Strong Arm Sports Spade!
Yes, sir.
Before we kick off the show, bro, I gotta say, happy holidays, Merry Christmas, happy holidays to you and your family, happy holidays to all the supporters and their family and friends out there, man. We glad you guys are able to join us on Christmas. It's Christmas, man. Leave in the comment section down below. Let us know what gifts you got, what gifts have you received, what gifts have you given? You know what I mean? Share your joy in the comment section down below. We will be in them comments reading those. Let us know. Spade!
Yes, sir.
Other than it being Christmas and, you know, holiday, you know, it's about to be 2017, another big year for SAS. A lot of things happened this week in sports. A lot of things happened. Mm-hmm. Spade, can I kick it off?
I want you to, bro. Kick it.
I'ma start in the NFL where I want to be. Y'all see me? I got my Santa Claus hat on, bolo hitting me in the face. Pause. Pause. If you're in podcast land, you may need to come to the Full House ENT on YouTube and see what the hell your boy is wearing on his head. But anyway.
Check on him.
But anyway, let's start in the NFL space. I want to start with Odell Beckham. I know we're going to take it to New York. We're going to talk Odell Beckham. Odell Beckham has had an interesting week, Spade. Mm-hmm. So let's start off. First of all, you know, the Cowboys played. Zeke Elliott jumped in the Salvation Army, little kettle, and Odell Beckham said, oh, he not getting fined for that. If it was me, I would have got fined for that. Odell Beckham had a problem. He got fined. He got fined for some cleats that he wore, paying a tribute to Craig Sager. He got fined for that. Spade. I mean, a lot of other things happened. I mean, the Giants since had a game since that. And, I mean, the Giants lost to the Eagles. And Odell Beckham had a little temper tantrum in the on his way to the locker room. Talking to the – he was growling at the gate and punching the gate and allegedly headbutting the gate. We don't know, Spade. Talk to me about Odell Beckham. What's going on with Odell?
I am so sick of Odell Beckham Jr. and his non-football antics. As long as he on the field during the game, I don't really have a problem with him. Other than that whole Josh Norman incident that I think he's trying to put behind him. And I want to put it behind me as well. Yeah. But the off the field stuff, whether it's on the sideline after a touchdown, whether it's on the sideline after a game, whether it's at the opposing team's locker room outside after the game, whether it's on Twitter, like anywhere else, I don't want to see Odell. I'm sick of him.
Let me hear him.
I don't want to hear him. I don't want to see him. I don't want to see him hitting them folks. I just don't want to see. I'm sick of him. To me, he comes across as the ultimate diva. And hold on. Before y'all jump on Odell defense wagon, which you guys have been doing a great job of on social media, let me get my point across. Wide receiver is a diva position. We know that. We've seen people like T.O. We've seen Ocho Cinco. We've seen Joe Horn. We've seen guys who were, you know, divas and all into their celebrations and all into themselves. But at some point, it stopped for them. Like, it never stops with this dude. It's always about him. Let's talk about the cleats for a minute, because I got an issue with him having an issue about getting fined with the cleats. I'm not a big fan of the NFL and their hypocrisies. The NFL is one of the most hypocritical leagues, professional leagues of in the sports realm anywhere you can find. But the one place they haven't been hypocritical is with their cleats and uniform policy. It's clear cut. I haven't played one game in the NFL. I know the cleat rule. Everybody knows it. It's well defined. It's been maybe 2 or 3 weeks ago the NFL had a dedicated wear whatever cleats you want to wear to support your cause day. It was known. Everybody knew it. That was your chance. Now, I get it. Don't get me wrong, Craig. Sega didn't pass away at that point. I understand that. Other than that, what they do is they let them wear whatever they want to wear at warm-ups, which, in case you guys don't know, is Odell Beckham stage. That boy loves some warm-up. In case you didn't know it, you can catch him out there hitting them folks and catching one-hand passes every week. Mm-hmm. You can wear whatever you want to wear during pregame warm-up. Once the game starts, you got a specific shoe color you have to wear. Everyone knows it. Odell tweeted, "I got fined $18K without a warning." What? What warning you talking to? You know the rules. You know it. You the one that show up to the game with two pairs of shoes. Spade, you got a pair for pregame. Let me cut you that guy, bro.
Before the game they played against the Eagles, Odell Beckham had on the Grinch that stole Christmas cleats, and he changed it to some other white cleats that had his school grass or dirt in the bottom of the cleat. So he clearly knew. He clearly knows the rule. He clearly knows the rules. But before you continue, Spade, I want to say one more thing. If, Spade, if I was to do, God forbid, but if something was to happen to you and I just want to pay homage to you and I know it may cause me to get fined, I'm willing to take that on the chin if I'm genuine and taking.
Thank you.
I'm willing to take that on the chin if I'm genuine and just paying homage to my friend, you know, my fallen friend. Now, I don't know if Odell Beckham knew Craig Sega, but if you already knew the rule, and you still decided to wear those Craig Sega cleats, whatever happened after that is on you.
Eat it. I agree, man. Eat it. But you
Yeah, man. Whatever happened after that is on you. So if you got fined and you said, "Oh, well, these some cleats I wore for Craig Sega that I auctioned off and they, you know, for charity." You take that on the chin and you just out some money. If my homie passed away, like I said, I don't know if he even knew Craig Sega, but I mean, Craig Sega passing away, Craig Sega was an icon to all us sport fans. You know, we see Craig Sega all the time on TV, and I told you the same thing with Stuart Scott, babe. You see these guys on TV so much, you grew up with them, you grew up watching them, you start to feel like they part of your family. You know what I mean? So I understand he don't even got to know Craig Sega, but whatever happened after you paying homage to Craig Sega, you got to take that on the chin. So for him to even come out and say, "Oh, I did this and the NFL found me when I was doing this for Craig Sega," it makes it seem disingenuous, and I don't like that.
I'm glad you said that. So check this out. I was talking to somebody on Twitter and they was like, "This is bad for the NFL." And I'm like, "No, it's not. The NFL got a clear-cut rule." And I hate defending the NFL. I don't even like the NFL like that to defend them. But they right here. They are right here. See, you can say Odell should have been allowed to pay homage to Craig Sega, who passed away. Craig Sega passed away and we know about it because Craig Sega is this big name. But somebody named John Brown passed away yesterday, who we don't know, that might mean something to somebody in the NFL. Should he be able to wear special cleats? And then what you get into is, why have a uniform policy? Yeah. If anytime somebody passes away, you can pay homage in your dress, then it's gonna be people rocking different cleats and everything every single football game. And one more point, and then I'll pass it back to you. Oh, actually, a couple of more points. A double point. How about that? Check this out. D'Angelo Williams, who we all know, if I'm not mistaken, I think his mother lost her battle with cancer.
Yeah.
He had breast cancer. We would find a cure on his eye black. It was written in the eye black. He got fined for that. Okay? So we know the rules. Cameron Hayward lost his father. He wrote Ironhead Hayward on his cleats and he got fined. That's his father. So if he can pay a fine for his father, why can't Odell pay a fine for Craig Sega, somebody that he probably was just inspired by? Odell, you don't get special treatment, fam. You like everybody else in that league. You just got curly blonde hair. Other than that, you can't break no rule. You ain't no better than nobody else. And as far as the jumping in the kettle, that would have got me fined. I hate when people do that. You got to be kind of wrapped up in you. I don't like people that be, "Oh, well, if I had a did," because it's always a scenario that you can say that on.
Yep.
In every aspect of life, you can look at something and say, "If I had a," but that's why you're you. That's why he's him. That's why we're different. And I'm just sick of Odell, bro. I'm sick of this guy.
He's a phenomenal player, Spade, but other players could say the same thing.
I want him
to
shut up.
Me too. Other players could say the same thing about Odell. Like, "Yo, if I would have did what Odell did to Josh Norman last year, like, I would have got kicked out the game." Like, so, look.
Say that.
Man. It's not only with the cleats, man. The NFL enforced rules, fine people for all different type of things. Zeke Elliott wanted to wear the crop top jersey. NFL said no, the kid don't wear it. They find you if your socks not this much above the knee, or if your pants is this much above the knee. Like, come on. We know the rules. And I don't even play in the league and I know these rules. Come on, man.
Exactly.
These guys know these rules, man. For Odell to be tripping, I want Odell to just focus on football because they just lost to the Giants. That's why he was in that tunnel tripping. You had bigger fish to fry. And if you was that genuine, in my opinion, about the Craig Sager, you would have took whatever fine came on the chin.
All right, well, since we in the NFL, man, let's go ahead and move to another hot topic. It was hot to me. When I read it, I'm like, what? Yeah. So I don't know if you heard this, man. I got news coming out of Pittsburgh that Pittsburgh is still a great Terry Bradshaw. Kind of had some comments about head coach Mike Tomlin. Turns out, man, Terry Bradshaw is not a fan of Mike Tomlin. He says that he don't think Mike Tomlin is a great coach. If anything, he says he's more like a good cheerleader. Now, I got some opinions on this. I'm pretty sure you do. I'm going to go ahead and hand this one off, and I'm going to let you run the football with this one, man. Terry Bradshaw says Mike Tomlin is not a great coach. What you think?
First and foremost, Terry Bradshaw, I get it. You on TV, you get paid. You get paid to state your opinion. But a cheerleader, like, what is that? Like, what are you saying? Like, he's basically doing nothing? Come on, man. First of all, I want to start off by saying Tomlin is an elite coach. And he went to two Super Bowls, won one. Not only that, I see the big riff on Tomlin is he's this defensive coach. And the Pittsburgh defense has been bad. But the talent in that Pittsburgh defense has been horrible. So it's tough to coach up bad players. Man, for you to turn bad players into good players, it gotta be a special type of player for your scheme to turn. I mean, he done went through coordinator after coordinator. The talent has been bad. They got back Debo, James Harrison. He was with the Bengals, retired. They couldn't get a pass rush. They re-signed him, got him out of retirement to bring him back to bring a pass rush. I love Tomlin as a coach, man. I think Tomlin is an elite head coach. He had at least three offensive coordinators. I'm pretty sure when you're a head coach, you delegate. You're supposed to be good at delegating. You're supposed to lead men. And I think Tomlin does a great job at that. For him to be able to even in his interviews, he answers every question correctly. He blasts certain players when they need to be blasted. He reprimands players when they need to be reprimanded, i.e. Le'Veon Bell, i.e. Martavis Bryant, with the acts they've been doing over the past couple of years. I like Tomlin, and I don't know what would make Terry Bradshaw say these comments.
You know, this whole story is weird to me. Now, we all know Eric Dickerson just came out and kind of banged the cannon on Jeff Fisher. That started a snowball that ultimately got Jeff Fisher fired. Now, I don't know if Terry Bradshaw got in mind somebody he feel like he'd rather had a job, and maybe he's trying to start the same snowball effect, but I don't necessarily feel like it's fair criticism. Now, you can look at Mike Tomlin. Matter of fact, if I'm not mistaken, bro, I think early in the season, you proposed to question whether or not it was time for the Steelers to move forward from Mike Tomlin.
Yeah.
In that segment, we never once said we felt like Mike Tomlin wasn't a great coach. So here's some facts that I don't know if people know. Mike Tomlin has never had a losing season with the Steelers. His worst season was 8-8. He's never had a losing season with the Steelers. He's also, under his head coachness, his tutelage, if you want to call it that, the Steelers have been the fastest team to 100 wins in NFL history under Mike Tomlin. So Mike Tomlin he's produced on the field. He hasn't always won the big game, and I guess if that's a knock you're going to have on him, unfortunately, quite a few coaches fall under that. You know what I'm saying? Haven't won the big game. But he's actually been there twice, won it once. Another thing that really made the whole thing sound crazy to me was Terry Bradshaw said Bill Cowher is a great coach. But to me, after you say that, I don't hear nothing else you saying. I don't hear anything else you saying. I'm looking at Bill Cowher record right here. Bill Cowher had four seasons where he was sub 500. He did actually win a Super Bowl, so we'll give him that. But he only won one as well. So I don't know how you look at Bill Cowher and say he's great. You look at Mike Tomlin and say he's not great. And then I almost feel like the chili the line was, it was immature. It was more like trying to poke fun or trying to roast or whatever. Like, I like Terry Bradshaw. I want to say that. But this, to me, this is just crazy. Like, you got to, somebody need to check Terry Bradshaw's cup. Maybe it wasn't coffee that day. I don't know what he was sipping on, but he tripping. Especially if he think Bill Cowher was great.
And I mean Spade. Like what do he want? What do he want him to do with this defense? I have the defense right in front of me. Mike Tomlin ain't the guy drafting these guys. He's not drafting these guys. Let me tell you.
Right.
Let me tell you who's on this team. So we both like Ryan Shazier, right?
Oh yeah.
We both like Lawrence Timmons, right?
Mm-hmm.
James Harrison, yep. Old in the tooth, but we love James Harrison. But let's be honest, he's old in the tooth. They brought back James Harrison because the guy they drafted, Jarvis Jones, if I'm not mistaken, in the first or second round pick, this guy he's not even able to get on the field because he's not it. He ain't it. I mean, mm-hmm. Artie Burns, young DB. We don't know yet. We think he got some potential though. Cockrell, okay. Mike Mitchell, a hitter, but I mean, he gets beat in coverage a lot. Sean, I mean, like, ain't nobody looking at this team like, yo, this defense is some elite defense. And if I'm not mistaken, Mike Tomlin had these guys playing in the middle of the pack. And Spade, what was the stat after week 11? After week 11, this defense had been giving up, what, 14 points?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, never more than 14. Yep.
Come on, man. Like, I think he got these guys playing. I mean, it ain't Mike Tomlin for his players want to go out there and smoke marijuana and get suspended for team games.
I'm glad you said that.
If you have Martavius Bryant, if you have Le'Veon Bell for the first three or four games of the season, you figure they better, right? But it ain't his fault his players want to go out there and be stupid. He got to work with what he have. Come on, I don't agree with Terry Bradshaw. And like you, Spade, I like Terry Bradshaw on TV. But let's be honest, Terry Bradshaw kind of rode some coattails to some Super Bowl wins as well. He had the steel curtain defense. All them dudes was it. He had Lynn Swan. He had Stallworth. Like, this dude has some players. Like, let's not front. Like, Terry Bradshaw was just out there dotting them up. I mean, Spade, one of the most famous clips they show on NFL Films is Lynn Swan diving for a pass that Terry Bradshaw overthrew, and he falling all over the player trying to dive and catch the pass. He made the catch, but it wasn't a good pass. Let's just be honest. So, yeah. I mean, I get what Terry Bradshaw, I get he's on TV. He gets paid to state his opinion. I don't agree. I'm interested to know what the fans think in the comment section down below. Is it time for Mike Tomlin to be out of there? Do you think Mike Tomlin is a cheerleader? Like, I don't understand the cheerleader comment. I don't even understand what that means, Spade. Like, come on. I think it's blatant disrespect. And I mean, it's, Spade, when you look around the league at the trash coaches that's out there, bruh, you cannot say Mike Tomlin is not an elite coach in the league, man. When you look at this trash that's around. So, my last point. I wish I would have heard anything Terry Bradshaw said about Jeff Fisher, because if he was on board with Jeff Fisher and he say Mike Tomlin is a cheerleader, then something up.
Yeah, he should have been screaming that from the mountaintops.
Yeah,
you,
man.
You know, I feel like, you was talking about the defense is not great. I don't think their defense is bad. You know,
I'm not saying they ain't bad. I'm not saying they bad. I'm saying they ain't nobody scared of that defense. Spade, when I had the Cowboys before the season started to go 15-1, Spade, I was just trolling. But what game did I say we was going to lose? The Steelers. I was more so scared of the Steelers' offense.
Hey, Yeah,
I was more scared of their offense than their defense. I knew we was going to be able to put up points on their defense. My problem was, that offense is phenomenal. It's phenomenal. But
yeah,
they've been playing well. Like, the Steelers' defense has been playing better. Let me say playing better, not well. They've been playing better.
I feel like what people forgetting is, it's tough to replace a legend. You know, so this defense had to move on after Troy Polamalu's retirement.
Yeah,
that's a huge hit to your defense. And then, like you alluded to, he got offensive players that he can't keep on the field because of the things they like to do in their recreational time. That Mike Tomlin, that's not his job. He's the head coach. He's not their father. We're not talking about a high school team or a collegiate team.
That's right,
These are grown men expected to conduct themselves in a professional manner so that they can be out there on Sundays or Thursdays or Saturdays or whenever the hell else the NFL got these guys playing.
But and with that being said, Spade, he still like have them in the hunt. They still in the hunt.
Exactly.
With all that being
every
said.
Year. Every year.
Come on, man. Every year. I don't get it. But I'm interested to know what the fans think, Spade. You want to move on?
Yes, sir.
Let's go to the NBA. So if you guys didn't know, something happened in Miami. Yeah, they got a dub. Yeah, they got a dub. They got one dub.
Chill,
they got
one dub. Man,
they still trash. My Bulls kind of trash, too, which hurts. Yeah, oh, my gosh, it hurts. We look so bad. Chicago, what's up? But, Spade, and I'm not talking about the rumors that Dragic may want to be traded. Let me strong arm a topic in here real quick, Spade. We want to talk about what we have written down. But, Spade, Dragic want to be traded. You move. Yep. Do you move the Dragic?
Is water wet?
Let me ask you. I got a trade proposal for you, Spade. I don't know if the money gonna work, but I'm just talking out loud. I would do this trade. I would do Gordon Dragic for Rubio straight up. Do you take that if you Miami?
I don't want that trade because I feel like this.
You got money off the books though.
Yeah, I want his contract gone. I definitely want that gone. But I want a PG who can score a little. I don't want to shoot first PG, but I want a PG who can score a little. And, you know, I don't know, man. You got Josh Richardson who can shoot. You got Tyler Johnson who can shoot. We got some pieces, man. We got Justice Winslow who's still, you know, becoming a great player. I don't know, man. Right now, I just feel like Rubio, the perfect home for Rubio would be a place where he got shooters all around him that he can just create for. And I don't know that that's
so back
overseas right now.
So back overseas.
You said that. But yeah, if the Dragon won out, bye. Like, right. Matter of fact, I help him. I help you get your stuff back.
Well, this topic is about the Heat retiring the Big Diesel number. Shaquille O'Neal, at halftime, they retired Shaquille O'Neal number. Spade, let me ask you. Why? Why did they retire Shaq number, Spade? Shaq only played 2 or 3 seasons there. I mean, do that mean they got to retire Gary Payton number? I mean, he was there with Shaq. Do they got to retire his number?
Sure, why not?
Spade, why did they retire the Diesel number? First of all, Shaq from New Jersey, man. I love Shaq. Shaq. I want Shaq on the show.
Me that this is a debate. I saw some Miami fans on Twitter saying, wow, the Heat retiring Shaq's jersey. Yeah, he helped us win our first championship. But well, I don't even know why you go after that. But he, you know, when he left, he said some things about the team and he said some things about the owner. I think he threatened to physically assault the owner or something like that. Man, look, let me tell you something. Miami retired the jersey of Michael Jeffrey Jordan, who never played a damn game in Miami.
Why did they do that, Spade?
We just like looking up at jerseys in our rafters. They look good up there, apparently. But this ain't even a question. If we retire Jordan's jersey number, we definitely better put Shaq's up there. I don't care if they put Alonzo Mourning. I think Zoe already up there.
Yeah, Zoe up there, and I think Tim Hardaway is up there.
Yeah, man. Throw Gary Payton up there. I don't care if you can put Dan Marley. If you want to, you can make it where we ain't got but about 8 different choices for your jersey number to be. Put them all up there. But I'm exaggerating, but Shaq number definitely need to be up there. He was a huge piece to the 06 championship, and I know we had a young Dwayne Wade. And that another
who
reason
was cooking,
why I'm
by the way.
Shaq. He was cooking. But want me to tell you why he cooked so well? When Shaq came in, Shaq let it be known without a shadow of a doubt. This is Dwayne Wade's team. He's the man. I'm option number 2. Shaq wasn't washed at this point, y'all. Don't forget. Shaq was not washed at this point. So he came in instantly and humbled himself to make that team better. Because I don't care what people say. Like, you look at Golden State, people say, well, we ain't got no... We don't have no hero or no leader. We're all the same. That's the BS that they say for the camera. Every team has to have a definitive number one. And Shaq let it be known. He came in, humbled himself. He made Dwayne Wade the definitive number one. And he helped Miami win their first title. Without a shadow of a doubt, you put Shaquille O'Neal jersey up in them Raptors before I come down there and put my foot in somebody's butt. You put it up there. That's what I say. I can't even believe this is a discussion. I saw Heat fans like, I don't think we should be retiring Shaq's jersey. I'm like, what? What?
Spade.
Man, you want to hear some 06 numbers from the Diesel? You want to hear that?
Spade.
I got some.
Go ahead.
If you want to.
Go ahead.
I just want to let you know, man. Shaq averaged 20 points a game, 9 boards a game in the regular season, shot 60% from the field. When they got in the postseason, his numbers dropped. He only averaged 18 points a game, but he averaged 10 boards, and he shot almost 62% from the field. So Shaq was, don't think without a shadow of a doubt, he was a huge piece to us winning that championship. Huge. Shaq, go.
I'm not arguing that, Spade. I'm saying, it's some other dudes that was on that team. You going to retire Antoine Walker number? You going to retire Jason Williams number?
Did he give us
20
again? Did he give us 20 and 10?
You going to retire Gary Payton? You going to retire Jason Capone? What about UD? Y'all going to retire UD jersey?
GP wouldn't even start. GP didn't even start on that team.
What about Michael Doliak? Shannon Anderson. Spade. I'm just asking the question. Wayne Simmons was on that squad, Spade. James Posey. I mean, what we doing?
You can put Spade, Jason Williams jersey up there.
Can we get SAS retired down there? I mean, the way Miami just threw him in the Raptors, I feel like we got to hang up a Full House ENT sweatshirt. Like, the way they retired people jerseys.
I tell you what. Y'all can fire all the shots in Miami you want to. Shaq jersey deserves to be in the Raptors.
Look, man, okay? I love Shaq, man. I'm a huge Shaq fan. I love that dude, man. I love Shaq, man. That's my guy. I ain't mad at Shaq getting his jersey. I mean, he ain't say you retire my jersey. He ain't say none of that. They say, hey, Shaq, you want your jersey retired? Shaq like, hell yeah. Miami, I mean, who they calling next, man? Because they just going on ain't down the list.
Jason Williams, white chocolate, come get your jersey in the rack.
Don't nobody want to wear 55 anyway. So, yeah, just retire it. Just retire that jersey.
Yeah, man. Yeah, I'm really upset. They tried to do my boy like that, man. The D's came in there and gave us 33 minutes a game, man. Shaq was not washed. That Shaq right there.
I don't know who says Shaq was washed, though. I don't know who
said that. They didn't say he was washed, but I'm saying people keep talking like, oh, well, that was old fat Shaq. It was all Dwayne Wade. No, it wasn't. He was getting fat, but he still was the most dominant force in the league at that time. He still was a walking two-point basket or a trip to the charity strike. Trust me.
Let's move on from this heat
10
talk.
10 years ago, man. I ain't so old and I don't forgot a decade ago.
Let's move on from this heat talk. Thank y'all for signing the petition to get James Harden and the Houston Rockets banned from this show. Thank you. Let's keep glad that going every that. Week.
Let's I'm keep glad that you going. Said that. Next segment, man, we want to go to Houston and talk about... No, I'm just kidding. No, but what I really want to do, man, I want to talk about a guy who... I don't even know how we segue to this. This guy is known for being a coach. For me, the most memorable thing is him coaching the Denver Nuggets and having the Nuggets looking good, but not quite great.
Well, we got different memories, Terry Bradshaw. My best memory of this coach is him coaching the Supersonics.
Yeah, well, not for me. I guess because I like that they had the 30-30 club with Melo and AI. Both of those guys was averaging 30 points a game for a brief stint. I really like that. But anyway, we're talking about George Karl, who is writing a book. Why not? For those of you that don't know, when you got money and you somebody, not for like you or I, but when you got money and you somebody, writing a book essentially means talking. And somebody else write the book for you. But George Karl is writing a book, and it's called Furious George. I don't know why he's furious. He's been a coach in the league for a while. He's made money. He's had success. And apparently he's furious. Somebody just thought that was a catchy title. The book is not out yet, but little excerpts of the book have started to leak, and he is banging the cannon on some of his ex-players. This ain't the first time we've seen this. Phil Jackson wrote a book. He probably told a little bit more than his players wanted him to tell as well. George Karl, though, he got three people in particular that he seemed to be really airing out. I'm talking about Carmelo Anthony. I'm talking about Earl Shirtless, J.R. Smith, and I'm talking about Kenyon Martin, the original K-Mart is what I call him. George Karl was pretty tough on these dudes, and the one quote that stuck with me, he said his job was made hard because his players had bad fathers. LaParis, I know you heard these quotes as well. How do you feel about them?
Irresponsible. It was just irresponsible with George Karl, man.
Even if you're trying to sell a book?
I mean, I get it. I get it. You want people to buy your book, you put the juice in there. I get it. Gotcha. But, I mean, come on, man. Like, just blatant disrespect, man. He also said something about J.R. Smith didn't listen to him because his father said, whenever you get in the game, just start chucking. Like, just shoot. I just think Spade, we don't know Melo personally. I'm pretty sure he knows Melo way better than us. But for him to say he said Melo was a all about me guy, He said Melo was an all about me guy, and if Melo, he was a user of people. That's what he said about Melo. He didn't want to share the spotlight, and if he felt he had to share the spotlight, he wanted that guy out of there, which is just, I mean, Melo handled it responsibly and professional. They asked Melo about the excerpts, and he was like, nope, like, I'm not, no way, not touching it. No words. He didn't say anything. But, I mean, George Carl just came out banging the cannon. I get you trying to sell a book, but golly. I mean, shouldn't some, Spade, me and you done had some personal conversations. And if I was to write a book, bro, I'm not putting some of this stuff we talk about in the book. Right? I mean, God, you don't got to put everything in the book. And you can steal something. The book's still going to sell because it's from George Carl. Like, people want, I mean, not me, but people want to.
I don't know.
Spade, I think people will want to read the book regardless, man. They read Phil Jackson book. And I mean, Phil Jackson didn't go down hard on Kobe. He went hard, but he didn't go that hard.
Yes, he did.
But he didn't go that hard as to talk about, well, you know, his father was a womanizer type of thing. Come on.
Well, that's a little different. I mean, like, he didn't speak to what type of fathers, like, what their father's issue was. He just said that they either wasn't in their life or they, he said that Kenyon Martin and Carmelo Anthony had the great burden of dealing with having a whole lot of money young and didn't have a father to teach him how to act. I kind of feel like, I know this is going to catch you off guard, but I don't really feel like I don't see what everybody's so upset about. I mean, I feel like people's mad that he said it, but I don't think anybody's making an argument that this stuff isn't true. As far as J.R. Smith's father told him as soon as he get in the game not to listen to George Carl and shoot, I don't think that's hard to believe. Have y'all seen J.R. Smith play? He played like he got an earpiece, and his dad is still telling him to shoot the damn ball from an earpiece. And we've seen that. I played ball when I was younger. We had a dude on our team whose mom would sit on the bench about 3 feet down from the coach and just be the polar opposite, whatever the coach say. The coach would be like, go here, go here. And the mom would be like, stay where you at, stay where you at. Like, we've all seen those parents. So that's not hard to believe. And I see a lot of people. LaParis, I told you off camera once that when my younger sister was going to Georgia State University, David Banner came and gave a lecture on, and I'm going to quote him before y'all get all tight with me. These ain't my words. These are David Banner's words. David Banner said, the reason why we have so many bitch-made dudes is because so many dudes are raised by bitches. And a dude in the class was ticked because he was like, I was raised in a single mother, you know, situation, and my mom ain't no bitch. And Banner was like, hold up, before you take my wording out of content, I was raised by my mom. But what I'm saying is, as good a job as my mom did, my mom couldn't teach me how to handle situations like a man because she wasn't a man. She did her best, and she did a good job, but she raised me. I at a young age, I handled situations like a female. That's how I saw her handle situations. And I see it a lot. I know for a fact that not having that strong male, it don't have to be your father, but not having that strong male role model in your life to teach you how to handle some situations can be an issue and it can be a burden. I'm broke. I see broke people not know how to handle situations without their father. Mm-hmm. I can't imagine being a millionaire young, 19, 20 years old, millionaire, without being taught how to handle situations like a man. I could imagine it could make for some sticky situations in the locker room. LaParis, I ain't gonna name drop. Me and you know a dude right now that you and I both say that dude was clearly raised by his mom. Like, we say it's obvious to us. So I don't feel like George Carl, I don't think he lied. The question is just whether or not it's unethical to talk about. I think that's the issue. But I don't think he's lying here. And I don't really feel like that's that bad. Because those guys, they made it. They came from bad situations and they made it.
Like, just because they ain't had a father there don't mean it wasn't another male figure there that took the role, man. And George Carl just saying they like this because they ain't had no father. They probably had uncles. I think Melo, if I'm not mistaken, got bigger brothers. Who knows? I mean, I don't know. But I mean, just because the father wasn't there don't mean somebody wasn't there that was like, yo, simmer down, or, you know, do this, do that. Like, I don't know, man. Like I said, I like George Carl, man, but I just think you want to write a book, you don't have to put all that.
Gotta all put that juice in it, man. People don't give a damn what George Carl got to say.
Yeah, but I'm saying you could put juice in there without saying that. Like, you could say George Carl been coaching in the league for probably over 20 years. You telling me he got to talk about this like that? Come on, man.
Yeah.
Been coaching for a long time, George Carl. I want to believe you better than that. You could have put something else in that book, man.
I'm going to tell you something, and I'm probably going to get some hate on this. And this, like, this is coming way out of left field. I love Grantland. I love Jalen, Jacoby, I love him. But when Grantland first started, you know what made me check in? Because Jalen used to give accounts of things that happened, like, behind the scenes. Like, he talked about Vince Carter body slamming the coach in the locker room. Like, that's the stuff people want to hear about. We see what happens on the court. We see that. I don't want him to come out here and talk about what happened on the court.
George Karl has been in the locker room for all these years, and you want to speak. Like, you can't tell no other story what happened in the locker room or none of that other crap. You got to talk about, like, you could have talked about way, I'm pretty sure it's way better stories George Karl could have talked about.
Bro,
way better.
This information, that's probably one page.
Oh, you've been in the locker room all these years.
Some of that other stuff in there.
All these years.
It's a lot of pages in this book, I'm willing to bet. He's furious. And he's furious. It's Furious George, for crying out loud. You can't control no Furious George. He's selling books. I get it. I'm not even upset with the dude, man. Like, I get it. I know everybody upset with him, but I can't be too mad with him.
I'm about to say, you gonna buy the book? You buying the book?
I'm gonna wait on everybody to leak out all the juicy stuff, and I will be scouring the web for it.
They leaked the juice already.
That's just a little bit of the juice. I feel like it's
more. Babe, that's all the juice.
You think
Trust me. Yeah, man, that's nah. That's Tupac and Rodman's on the roof. That's all the juice. That's it.
Nah, it's some more. Gotta be.
That's it. Let's move on.
All right, man.
Spade, you taking it to college basketball, and I know y'all like, what? We don't really talk to college basketball yet, on this show until it gets to the tourney. That's when when it gets to the tourney. Because that's when college basketball matters, when it gets to the tourney. But Spade, something happened down there in Duke. Grayson Allen been kicking it with Draymond Green. This dude can't seem to keep his feet on the ground. Been kicking people, Spade. He kicked some people. Coach K, Mike Krzyzewski said, We gotta sit him down. People. Huh?
He tripped some people. He's not kicking people.
Spade, he kicked that dude, man. He's sticking that leg out and he keep kicking people. He tripping, kicking, whatever. Spade, Coach K said, this dude ain't representing Duke how we want to be represented, and we gotta sit him down. If I'm not mistaken, as of yet, no length of suspension has been given yet. But Spade, what do we think about Grayson Allen being sat down?
Honestly? I don't understand. I feel like they making a bigger deal out of this thing than
it is. We talking about three. You are the king of Draymond Green out of here.
Yeah, kicking people in their nuts and tripping somebody off. They ain't by each other on the scale.
Spade, he been kicking folks, man.
Bro, I'm cool if he gets suspended a game or two. I'm cool if he get ejected. Draymond ain't got nothing but suspended a game, and he done kicked numerous nuts. He kicked nuts for a living, basically. Spade. This man got suspended indefinitely for tripping. I don't really feel like it's that big a deal. I will tell you this, though.
Did you see the little? Did you see the temper tantrum on the bench?
Yeah. You mean something similar to what Odell do and get camera coverage for?
Oh my gosh.
Odell had one of those every week. I mean, Grayson ain't go fight no kicking net, did he? Then he didn't go marry the kicking net, did he? Then he didn't go lay down and have intercourse with the kicking net, did he?
Please, Spade.
I'm just saying, this is what Odell do.
And you got to sit him down right now and calm his nerves.
Definitely.
Because it sets up for the future, man. You got to calm him down and let you know, bro, you can lose this like this. Get right now. Get right.
Man, first of all, something tells me Grayson Allen lose this, he going to be okay. Let me say that first. Second of all, somebody said the only reason why they're making a big deal out of it is because it's Coach K and people don't like Coach K. I disagree. I agree, but I disagree. People are making a big deal out of it because Coach K is so prestigious that at times he'll want to talk to an opposing player about how they should carry themselves. So you can't talk to somebody else about how they should carry themselves if you can't control the people that play for you.
But that matters, doesn't it? Don't that matter?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Oh, okay.
That's what I'm saying. But it ain't because people don't like Coach K. That ain't why. If people don't like Coach K, it's because he is so judgmental at times of others. My thing is this, though. I do feel like he should have been suspended. Probably ejected from the game. Maybe suspended one game. Honestly, me, I think
I thought you was going to be all over this. You're going a little too light for my liking.
It's Christmas, man. It's Christmas. I think
the Cavs play the Warriors tomorrow. When Draymond kicks somebody, I'm going to be right here on the text like, Spade, it's Christmas. Stop tweeting. Draymond needs to be kicked out of the game.
Are we really saying that kicking people and tripping somebody are they the same?
He is literally kicking his foot out, tripping these guys. Yes.
Kicking your foot.
Keep your feet on the ground, Spade. And
kicking somebody, that ain't the
same. Spade, he kicked that dude in his inner thigh. 2 inches up, it would have been another region.
He didn't kick him. He kicked his foot out, and the dude ran into his foot. That's how you execute a trip. Now, I'm a tripping connoisseur. I know about tripping.
Spade, you better hope Draymond don't kick nobody tomorrow.
No, I don't care if he do or not, because I don't feel like they the same. I don't know how you missing me here. They not the same in severity to me.
That's just like a Duke.
I hate Duke, and you know I hate Duke. I just feel like, anyway, let me say this, and then I'm going to pass it back to you. Here's what people better watch out for. The whole indefinitely thing, that's a smokescreen, y'all. I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. First of all, I don't know if y'all saw it. To me, I'm more upset with Coach K. Everybody flipping out over Grayson Allen tripping somebody, that's not a big deal to me. It's really not a big deal to me. What I'm more tripping out about is the fact that Coach K was pissed. If you saw him in the post-game interview, he was pissed. He felt like the fact that he coached up Grayson Allen and got him to apologize should have made everybody forget about it. And he was really on the defense. I even heard Coach K say throwing shots. I don't know who taught him that. He was like, if anybody want to throw shots at Duke or me, that's a position I'm comfortable in. And I mean, he was getting all Brody. I was like, look at Coach K. Then when they come back and say he's suspended indefinitely, he didn't put a time on it. I guarantee you, I'm going to give you the timetable. As soon as something else happens, when people start talking about something else, watch Grayson return. Coach K is just doing this as a smokescreen to make y'all forget about it. As soon as y'all forget about it,
he'll be back. I don't think it's going to be that long. I say 2 or 3 games. It ain't gonna be long. I mean, I think two or three games, and I think like the next couple of games, they play like some trash teams. Like, I didn't even look up their schedule, but I think they play some trash teams. So it ain't, they got All-American blue chip talent down there. Ain't like 2 or 3 games without Grayson Allen, they going to be, oh my gosh, the season is over. Like, they going to be,
but you know why he didn't say 2 or 3 games?
Be all right with or without Grayson Allen.
You know why he didn't say 2 or 3 games?
Why? Because it's going to be 1 game?
Because the Grayson Allen haters, like Lil Paris over here, is going to be like, only 2 games. He is doing the
first
same
of all,
thing.
I don't care that much about college basketball to
and
even
his
care. I'm just
is,
saying.
His arms is going to be doing like this. Only 2 or 3 games. He's kicking people like Draymond. He should be sat down. But he knows saying indefinitely going to make people satisfied. People hear indefinitely in their mind thinking it's a big number. It's not going to be a big number. He'll be back like he left his car keys, y'all. Watch.
I don't know. Boy, you are. It's Christmas. You right? Because you
how,
are
how many
a
games
different person
Draymond
around
get?
Christmas. You must have got a great gift.
How many games did Draymond get for kicking people in the nuts? First of all, how many scrotums have Draymond kicked? At least 3 or 4.
Numerous.
How many games have he missed as a result of it?
1.
So this man tripped 3 people. He should get sat for like a season? Like, this is crazy.
And who said a season?
I'm just saying, like, I don't know, man. I really feel like people blowing it out of proportion.
Man, when that kid was on that bench and was spazzing out over there, that kid looked like he had some issues. He needs to be sat down and calmed down. Like, he needs
to
be
calmed
down. How
many games have Odell been sat down for acting like that on the sideline?
Spade, have you been here with me every week? When Odell was spazzing out, that first week when they played, I said, yo, they should have pulled him out the game. Like, the coach should have said, yo, have a seat, kid. I said that. Like,
You did.
Nah, he didn't
sit down. But you know what it got him? You know what it got him? More media coverage. Now cameras just follow this man everywhere. They made his brand bigger. He's on the cover of a video game. So what I'm saying is, if you got Draymond kicking folks in the nuts, not missing no time on the court, when you got Odell acting like a spoiled brat for the cameras, because don't think that Odell didn't know the cameras was there when he was growling at himself at the wall in the corner like a bad kid in kindergarten. They know what they doing. And this is what happens. You got these collegiate kids watching y'all Y'all ain't getting no discipline for it. They pros. This man
and that's
a kid.
Why and that's why you
the
check
pros
them.
Pros ain't getting.
That's why you gotta check them, Spade. Well, your kids go to school and see other kids doing crap all the time. What you tell them? Not in my house. Not right.
Absolutely.
You check them, right?
Absolutely.
But exactly. I mean, I that's why them. Just because they see something don't mean it's permitted here. And that's why Coach K got to sit him down. Just because you see Draymond kicking it
for one game.
Just,
let
hey,
me ask
I mean,
you, what's the perfect suspension for you?
Two or three games. But all jokes aside, I really do think this kid got some issues. The way he was spazzing out on that bench, I'm looking like, yo, that dude looked crazy. He looks
you
crazy.
Know what I think the spaz out was, though? And I know y'all going to feel like I'm defending. Let me go ahead and say
I can't believe how hard you're going for Duke.
I hate Duke. I absolutely hate Duke. Y'all know I'm a Miami fan. But before Miami actually had a program that could compete on the hardwood, I kind of leaned toward the Tar Heels. Of course, you know, I'm a Jordan fan, so I like the Tar Heels. So, of course, I don't like Duke. You can't like both. I don't like nobody from Duke but Grant Hill. That's the only person from Duke I rock with, and Kyrie kind of. A little bit. But I honestly feel like that
like
tantrum
JJ.
On the sideline.
You like J.J. Redick.
No, sir, I don't. You no, like sir, JJ I don't. Redick. Not at all. I feel like the tantrum on the sideline was more about, to me, it was that, it's what happened when a mama tell a kid, when your daddy get home tonight, you're going to get your butt whooped. You get that, you get that. I don't feel like it was, what could he have been upset about? Like, he knew he tripped. Like, you know what I'm saying? I don't know. To me, his reaction was, I'm going to get in trouble. The camera's been watching me. They made a big deal about this. I have came out and said that I've grown and matured mentally, and I'm not going to let my competitive spirit get the best of me. And here I am again. I'm going to get in trouble. That's what it looked like to me. He looked like he wanted to cry. He probably did cry.
He looked like he wanted to fight.
Nah, listen. He don't want no sauce.
Okay. Listen, man. Listen, man, I'm interested to know what the fans think. Are you team Duke with Spade over there? Are you team Grayson Allen? Or do you think this kid should have been sat down? Let me know in the comment section down below.
Let me say this one more, and then I'll shut up. I would have been better if they sat Grayson for one game and sat Coach K for three games. Coach K, the person I got a problem with. That's who my problem with. Coach K, sit him. All right, let's move forward, bro. Last show. We gave these guys a top five. We wasn't really sure how it was going to be received, and turns out they loved it. They want more of it. In case y'all didn't know, last episode, you need to go check it out if you did miss it. We gave you guys our top five hoops movies of all time.
You see how we just skip right over NFL movies, like football movies? I see how you do, Spade. I see.
They make football movies?
I see. Okay. We skip right over that, and now we got to go ahead, continue.
Because I didn't even say what this week was going to be. And I got football movies wrote down. But since you want to just be Odell and Grayson Allen all about it, I'll just change it. This week is Christmas, man. We got to give you guys our top five Christmas movies of all time. I don't feel like I should have to say this, but apparently I do. These are our lists. You know what I'm saying? So you can't really argue with me about what I like. I just want to make sure I get that across. LaParis, you on the hot seat? When I was making this list, I realized that I really only like three Christmas movies. So I'm winging it on the last two. You on the hot seat, buddy. Go. 5-1.
Oh, you want me to go all five? I thought we was going to go five.
You want to go back and forth like salt and pepper? We can do that.
Yeah.
All right, let's go.
At five, I have Bad Santa. Billy Bob Thornton did a great job. Funny movie. I haven't seen Bad Santa 2, but Bad Santa is definitely my number five top Christmas movie. Give me Bad Santa at number five.
Okay, so we both went comedy somewhat right here. For me, number five, I went Elf.
Okay.
Because Will Ferrell's an idiot. So I went Elf at five.
Okay, I'm not mad at that. At four, I have another comedy movie. I have Christmas with the Cranks with Tim Allen. Another hilarious movie. You know, get you in the Christmas spirit. If you haven't seen it, you need to rent it, buy it. I don't know if it's on Netflix. Netflix it. Amazon
download
it. Do whatever you do. Get Christmas with the Cranks. I promise you, you will die laughing. Christmas with the Cranks.
Wow. That's a hell of an endorsement for a number four. Number four over
here,
man.
My top three is the best top three Christmas movies of all time.
We'll see. Number four, I got a Charlie Brown Christmas. Charlie Brown is a staple. And whoa.
Oh, don't my owe
your God about Charlie Brown, bro. Charlie Brown, you got to watch yourself some Charlie Brown at Thanksgiving, at Halloween, and at Christmas. A Charlie Brown Christmas. Go.
Is that even considered a movie?
Are you
all right? It's like 40 minutes.
Are you all right?
And that's with commercials. It's really a half an hour.
Are you all right?
Spade, at number three, I got Home Alone, a classic. Home Alone is a classic movie. Definitely considered one of
a Christmas movie, though?
Home Alone? Yes! Home Alone is a Christmas movie, man. Home Alone is number three on my list. Spade, you better have Home Alone on your list.
I don't.
Oh, my God, Spade.
I don't think, like, I'm talking about movies that just kind of, they nostalgic every... I'm good on that. And number three, I'm not really sure the title. Somebody gonna give me a hard time about it, but it's like this Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer movie, but they kind of like puppets. Know what I'm talking about?
Oh my gosh, I know what you're talking about, Spade. You got Frosty up there too, Frosty the Snowman.
So you got a problem with Rudolph and Charlie Brown?
I got a problem with Rudolph and Charlie Brown, and I love Rudolph and Charlie Brown.
It don't
but are those
like
considered
it.
Movies?
Yes.
You little puppet look like they were stitched together. So you got,
don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Right now, I got Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer.
You got Frosty the Snowman, Spade, yes or no?
Right now, I got
Rudolph.
Is
Frosty on your list?
Right now, I got Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer.
Okay, number two, I have a Christmas story. Number two, I have a Christmas story. Ralphie, Spade, I know you've seen a Christmas story. TNT and TBS show it on rerun. It's coming on tonight, Christmas Eve, for like 24 hours. I know you've seen
those reindeer coming on tonight.
Spade, I know you've seen A Christmas Story with Ralphie. Tell me you've seen that.
I don't have to tell you anything.
Oh, definitely a classic. Y'all shoot your eye out, like Spade. It's a classic. I know you probably, if you haven't seen
you're
that movie.
You're not the law.
Look,
where we at?
That's my number two, man. That's number two. At Spade,
two,
go.
My list is better than yours already. Bro, I got How the Grinch Stole Christmas at two.
So Frosty number one on your list? Oh my God. How the Grinch Stole Christmas. Look at Spade list, y'all. At number one.
So you don't like that movie? You don't like How the Grinch Stole Christmas?
At number one, I have the all-time best Christmas movie of all time.
This sucks.
And that's National Lampoon's A Christmas Vacation with Chevy Chase.
Sucks.
It's a classic. One of the funniest. It's still funny to this day. I'm telling you, get that movie. It's a classic. You'll love that movie. National Lampoon's A Christmas Vacation with Chevy Chase. That's the all-time best Christmas movie of all time. Spade, what's number one on your list?
Number one on my list is the best Christmas movie ever, and that's
Frosty
A Christmas Snowman. Story. What?
What did you
a
say?
A Christmas Story.
Oh, okay.
A Christmas Story.
Okay, so we're
the
right.
best
that's
Christmas
number,
movie
that's
all the
number
time.
Two on my
I
list.
Feel like we did something different with our list. Like, these are nostalgic shows, movies that you watch every year. You don't watch National Lampoon's Christmas every year?
Yes, I do. Yes,
why?
I do. Because it's funny.
It's not that funny, bro.
Spade, that movie is
a
classic,
Christmas Story, number one.
Bro.
How the Grinch Stole Christmas, number two. Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. Charlie Brown Christmas. Elf.
How you put Rudolph and Charlie Brown, but didn't put Frosty the Snowman?
Maybe
anyway.
You should have put it in front of Home Alone. Don't
Absolutely
nobody watch
not.
That every
like,
year.
Listen, y'all.
You watch
as
Home Alone every
year?
As
usual, we want you guys to leave your top five Christmas movies.
They are movies.
Spade, they like 30 minutes.
So to you, the definition of a movie is long.
No. That's not true. I didn't say that. They're more shows or cartoons. If we would have said best Christmas shows.
It can be a cartoon movie. That's a such thing,
I'm
you know?
If we would have said shows, those are suitable. In my opinion.
Your opinion's wrong.
Are shows.
Your opinion's wrong, buddy.
I can't wait to the comment section. Get out to Spade. Leave your top five Christmas movies in the comment section down below. Spade.
I know I said it was Christmas, but don't let the past gas y'all up. Don't get Dikembe Mutombo in this comment section over my movie.
Nah, he ain't blocking nobody, yo. He ain't blocking nobody. I will. It's Christmas. He ain't blocking nobody.
Hassan Whiteside with the block.
You kind of vetoed what I wanted to talk about last week. You kind of trumped me and said, yo, we got to talk about the top basketball movies. Mind you, we still haven't talked about the top football movies yet. But I wanted to talk about, me and Spade, let me tell you something. Me and Spade talk about this show a whole lot. And we like to foreshadow. If you don't know what that means, Google it. We like to foreshadow. Think ahead. Think after we made it. So we like to think ahead and, you know, think of things we'll do once we've made it, once this show popped off, once you guys continue with your support and help us build this to like a household name. So I'm on the gram and I'm searching. I'm looking on the gram and I see a known, should I say names, babe?
No, do not say names.
Okay, I'm not going to say names. I see a known rap artist, and I mean he threw $30,000. He's in the strip club. Oh, I'm sorry. He's in the gentleman's club. He's throwing $30,000 in the air on this stripper. I'm sorry. Exotic dancer. I'm sorry. Exotic dancer. College he's throwing $30,000 up in the air at this exotic dancer, and I'm like, "Yo, no way, like no way will I ever be that guy to just be in there. I don't care if I have millions of dollars, I would never be that guy to throw like $100,000 in the air at an exotic dancer." Me and Spade had a debate about this, and I was like, "Spade, this is the type of things we need to talk about on the show." So me and Spade had this crazy debate, and I wanted to bring it to you guys. If you guys made it successful, whatever you consider success. Let's say you make $100,000, you got $10,000 to spare. We was using SAS as the catalyst. We said SAS Blue. Let's say whoever network signed us and we got like a $500,000 bonus. I told Spade I gotta be the treasurer because Spade said he gonna blow money fast. I told Spade.
I didn't say that.
Said he gonna buy fur coats and shades and watches and cars. He'll be in the strip club throwing all these hundreds of thousands of dollars. And I said, Spade, no, I would not let. I said, bro, if we had to fight, I would not allow you to do that, yo. I don't care if I gotta seize this dude's bank account. I would not allow my homie to do that. And he was like, Spade, what did you say back to me?
Let me get him that, because you giving him, this ain't the true version that he give me, y'all. Let me give you the real version.
It's the truth. Go ahead, Spade. Why Spade put 100 on 10? Go ahead.
Nah, I'm going to keep it a bean. He said, Spade, it ain't no way. First of all, he spoke for me. And in case y'all don't know this, in our relationship, I'm the big brother, he the little brother.
That don't matter, right? I'm not about to let you go out there.
I would never throw no $10,000, and I would never let you throw $10,000.
That's not what you said, Spade.
Hold on. I said, I can't see me throwing $10,000. However, I have had so much money in my pocket at one time in my life that I've done some things I said I wouldn't do. And I've had so little money in my pocket that I've done some things that I said I wouldn't do. So I can't fathom throwing that now in the tax bracket I'm in now.
I could see myself
possibly being in a more wealthy situation. If I felt like celebrating, I could see myself throwing a couple racks. I didn't say no 10. I said throwing a couple racks. That man said, if we go to the strip club and you got $10,000, I ain't letting you go in with no more than $1,000. That's what he said to me. And I told him that he can't stop me from doing what
I
want to go in there and sponsor somebody's way through college.
Spade, you did not say that because we were speaking on the artist throwing $30,000. And you was like, yo, if SAS was the blow and if somebody was to sign up. Spade, you said if SAS was the blow and somebody signed us, you was like, yo, you can't see us celebrating. We pull up in the car and head over to the spot. He said, yo, I can see me in there celebrating, throwing $30,000. That's what you said.
I didn't say no 30. I never said 30.
Oh my gosh, yo. I never said 30.
I said I'd throw some racks. Celebratory racks. That's what I said. I ain't say no 30.
Listen, man. The point is,
This man said if he a millionaire, he ain't taking no more than $1,000 in a strip club. If he a millionaire. You can't do that in black strip clubs, not in Atlanta. Let the DJ find out you being cheap. See how that go for you.
So how much you taking, Spade? So how much you taking?
If I'm a millionaire?
Yeah.
I'm taking some racks, man. I'm taking some racks.
That's not a plural. How much? What is some
racks? I don't know. Not 30. Not 30.
15? Come on, 15?
Man. I don't know.
Spade, I won't let you do it, bro. No way. I won't let you do it. Me and you done had some personal conversations, and you be like, yo, I'm this, this, and that. I will not let you go blow money fast like that. I won't let you do it.
I won't let you do it. I'm taking more than
15 is too much. 10 is too much. We gonna go in there, we gonna buy some drinks, enjoy the view, and go to hell home.
I feel like in the tax bracket I'm in now, I could wild out and take one rack with me now. I feel like it. I mean, I ain't never done it, but I feel like I could.
Spade, you also said that you're going to buy these exquisite watches and fur coats. What about that?
I never said fur coats. I like watches. I told you I like... Look, you're changing the story now. Now we're talking about whole other stuff. This thing's supposed to be about strip clubs. The spinoff was this. I'm going to tell him this and then we can move forward. I told this man that I got a homeboy that I know personally went into there and bought a little more than a dance. He came out with a little more than a dance. We had that whole discussion. We both decided that wasn't the wave, per se. Maybe. Depends. Let's wrap this up, man, before I incriminate myself in here, man. Listen, let's wrap this up.
Listen, man. Bottom line is, I want to know, to the supporters, I hate to say a millionaire, but the dude that we was talking about was a millionaire. So let's just say you're a millionaire. Let's just say $1 million. You take in 30 grand.
You can't say $1 million because you know that man got more than $1 million. That man got more than $1 million. Paint it right.
Allegedly.
You gonna paint the picture.
Allegedly.
Don't put the sun on the ground. If you're going to paint it, put the sun up in the sky where it's supposed to be.
So what, $5 million? $5 million?
I'm talking 30 maybe. 30 mil.
Hey, I don't care if I had 30 mil. I still wasn't going in and throw 30 grand.
I mean, that's fine.
In the air.
I just want you to paint the picture
right. Exotic dance. But I mean, I could be old and a fuddy-duddy.
What is she paying her way through medical school?
That's her business. That's her business. That's her business. Listen, I want to know to the supporters, you had $30 million, man. You're an athlete. Yeah, you made it. You some superb athlete. You some dope artist. You cured cancer. You got something. Whatever you did to get your money, you made it. Are you throwing hella money? See, Spade just talking about some racks. That ain't good enough. You got to give an amount. He said 30 grand in the beginning. Night John
I never said 30
and just
grand.
Said racks.
Man, I never said 30. I promise y'all that. About to look at him the same
are you
way
throwing,
Gucci
are you
looked
throwing
at
30
grand Angela
to,
Yee.
To
an,
are you making it tsunami in the gentleman club to one exotic dancer? Because I'm not.
Right.
I'm not throwing all that money. And I go in there with my little $1,000, buy a $500 bottle, and they can have the other $500. Spade.
So you gonna get two dances.
I'm not getting no dance. I'm just in there to look. I'm looking.
The producers are in my earpiece saying, wrap this segment up.
I'm just looking.
It's on me. Let's wrap. Let's give them our special edition. Check this out. I don't know. I'm sure it's happened before, but I'm talking about in my life. I can't remember Christmas ever falling on a Sunday. I can't remember that. I really can't. But
Make
this
Christmas
is a special
on a Sunday.
In my life?
In my life? You was born before me. And if it's,
I'm only 19. Life. First of all, I'm only 19, so I don't know. I ain't been here long enough to have these type of experiences. I'm still very young. Anyway, man, a special edition Christmas Sunday Pick'em game. For this one right here, man, we're going to go to the NBA because the association is better than the
league. Y'all know I'm up in the
pick'em
games by two. I'm up by two. Go ahead. I am. I'm up two.
The
check the tape.
Game. I know, man.
Oh, okay, check the tape.
First of all, you hustled me out of my pick. You hustled me out of my pick.
No, I didn't. You changed because you wanted to change.
Now, I picked Portland. You hustled me out of it.
I said we could have the same pick.
You
said no.
You finessed me on live TV. You up to this week right here, man. Let's
it
go
should
to
be three,
NBA
though. Check the tape.
Christmas Day game.
Check the tape.
Cleveland Cavaliers, Golden State Warriors, NBA Finals rematch. LaParis, who you got?
I'm going. I'm going with the Warriors. The Warriors, they playing the Cavs. The Cavs home, though, but I'm still going with the Warriors. I mean, the Cavs are short. J.R. Smith, who we trusting to jack them shots? Iman? No, sir. Give me the Warriors. I'm taking the Warriors. Pick the Warriors so you only be down two, champ.
Don't tell me what to do.
I'm pick the Warriors, Spade.
Don't tell me what to do.
I'm the 19-year-old. Be smart, bro. Be smart.
Hush. When grown folks talking. Be smart. I think I want to go Golden State. I want to go Cleveland. But the reason why I'm not is because Brian been playing crazy minutes. Brian been playing like 45, 46, 47 minutes. And I know Brian is not from this planet. And he good. But I just...
They just played the Nets last night. Blew the Nets out. He ain't play like the whole third and fourth quarter. Spade, straight.
You know what? They in Cleveland, right?
They in Cleveland. Pick them, Spade!
You know what? Cleveland!
This is for you! I'm about to be up four!
Give me the Cavs.
I'm about to be up four!
Stop. You about to be up one. Give me Cleveland.
Spade, pick the Warriors, bro.
Don't talk to me, bro.
Shout out to Samsung. I'm picking the Warriors. I'm riding with your boys. They better not let me down. Shout out to Samsung. Spade!
That sound like a threat. You gonna threaten people on that?
Spade! Pick the Warriors, bro. I want you to still be down two, not three.
You don't tell me what to do.
Spade, it's like Madden. Once I get up three, that's ball game.
You're not the boss of me.
So you want to stick with the Cavs?
You got a strong arm this week or what?
Yes. Spade, you sticking with the Cavs?
Cleveland, this is for you.
Who do y'all have winning the pick'em game? It starts Sunday at 2:30, so we'll know. We'll definitely know.
But listen, Spade. Crazy Bone, Busy Bone. Hey, go talk to your boy Brian. Tell him don't let me down now.
Listen, man.
Everybody on East 1999 Eternal. Go.
Let's move on to the Strong Arm Performer of the Week, man. We give this award, the Heisman of Podcast, to the performer to Spade, don't give it to women. I do. I give it to women all the time.
Oh my god.
Sabrina has been my Strong Arm Performer of the Week.
End the year
numerous times. He has been my Strong Arm Performer of the Week. She has been my Strong Arm Performer of the Week numerous times. But we give this to a performer who raised his or her level and helped their team to victory. Spade.
Yes.
Heisman the Podcast. This award. Who's your Strong Arm Performer of the Week?
I'm going to give my award to a person playing NFL football. I like underdogs, man. I don't know if y'all know that a lot and know that or not. I like James Harden. I like people who... The rest of the world say,
baby,
you know,
man, we're going to get a James Harden quarter jar.
Can I get my speech?
Listen,
can I give
my
speech?
We're going to get a James Harden Houston Rocket dollar jar. I'm about to say quarter, but you talk it too much, so we need to raise the stakes. Every time you mention...
I don't carry quarters.
I said dollars. Every time
just letting you know.
Mention James Harden or the Houston Rockets, you got to put a dollar in the jar.
We won't give it away. Nothing.
We're going to give it away to charity.
But... Can y'all, anybody with brother, Sam, you got a little brother. Can your little brother make you do something? Because mine can't make me do nothing. I'm not putting no dollar in no jar. Bump that jar. I like rooting for the underdog, man. No better recipient of this award than Matt Moore. I want to go to the Miami Dolphins. Oh, those of you that follow me on Twitter, when Ryan Tannehill went down, no, this guy's deserving, bro. Take a playoff, sip you some water or something over there. When Ryan Tannehill went down, people was tweeting me like, Spade, what are y'all going to do? Your playoff hopes are over. And I said, no, Matt Moore is a more than capable reserve quarterback. This guy's been a starter before in the league. They say he's really a student. He's the type of person that wants to know the plays. Even though he may not be playing on Sunday, I knew he was going to be ready. I didn't know he was going to do this. He dropped the Jets off to the tune of 12 of 18 passing, 236 yards, 4 TDs versus the Jets.
The Jets trash.
J-E-T-S. Jets, Jets, Jets. We run that division. Where the Patriots at? Fins
Whoa,
up.
Whoa, bro.
For that performance, Matt Moore, you are my Strong Arm Performer of the Week. Well deserving, kid. Well deserved.
The Jets trash, though, Spade.
Hey, I didn't ask you.
Let me give y'all a real Strong Arm Performer of the Week. I'm going to Houston to a guy that came off the bench.
Oh, James ain't came off the bench.
Oh my gosh, he's still talking about James Harden. Put a dollar in the jar.
Put no dollar in your jar.
Put a dollar in the jar. I'm tired of talking about James Harden, man. They signed the petition to ban James Harden talk, and you breaking the rules.
It was 3 signatures. It was 3 likes on that. That ain't gonna fly.
I'm going to Houston. The Texans went down there and they paid Brock Osweiler $72 million. He ain't good enough.
They got some.
Good enough. So a guy came off the bench to save the day named Tom Superman S on your chest Savage. Tom Savage from Rutgers. Shout out to Tom Savage from Rutgers. Let me tell you what Tom Savage did. The Texans couldn't move the ball against the Jags. Tom Savage came in the game and threw 23 of 36 for 260 yards. He didn't have a touchdown, but guess what he didn't have, Spade? He didn't have a pick. He didn't have a pick. And for that reason, he let them in victory too when they was down the whole game with $72 million Brock Osweiler ass in the game. Tom Savage came in there, dotted him up, targeted Hopkins 42% more of the time than Brock Osweiler had all season. And for that reason, Tom Savage and leading them Texans to victory and from being from Rutgers. Tom Savage, you are my strong arm performer of the week. Tom Savage, let's go, Rutgers. I know he went to Pitt too. But that boy from Rutgers. Tom Savage, my strong arm performer of the week, babe. What you got to say?
I don't stop listening. I don't even know what you just said.
Bro,
I'm toned you out over here.
Bro, Tom Savage went wheels.
I'm looking at watches I'ma buy when I blow.
See? So anyway, listen, man. We want to thank you guys for watching this holiday edition of Strong Arm Sports. Want to say Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. I don't think we have a show before New Year, do we? Do we have a show before New
Maybe.
Year?
Maybe. If I can get you to show up to work.
Oh, yeah. Next week will be the 31st. We will have one more show before New Year. But what I want to say, Merry Christmas, man. We want to thank you guys for taking the time out of your day to kick it with us, Strong Arm Sports. We want you guys to leave all of your thoughts in the comment section down below. Let us know. Also, let us know what you received for Christmas, what you gave out for Christmas, man. We want everybody to enjoy the holidays. Definitely enjoy it with your family. Appreciate your family. Love your family because you never know when they're going to be gone. So, you know what I mean? Hug somebody. Love somebody. Spade, you got anything else to add? As usual, if you guys don't want to see, two dudes talking in the box, we got audio podcasts everywhere. SoundCloud, Podomatic, iTunes. We want to thank y'all. We was in the 60s this week, man. Thank y'all for your continued support. Happy holidays. We'll see you guys next episode. We out.
Peace.